Okay, guys, so today I want to give you a free session on suspensive sales. I know that in examination setup, when you are given a note that is involving a suspensive sale, it's quite a complicated adjustment. So today I'm just going to give you a free session on how you can quickly account for suspensive sales. So basically, for suspensive sales, maybe as just an introduction, this is Nitt-Gritt College, a private college. We normally do our sessions in the evening from 7 p.m. up to 9 p.m. But we can have also one-on-one sessions with the different arrangements. For those that are comfortable learning during the day, we also have such arrangements. Okay, so today we are mainly focusing on suspensive sales. So we have suspensive sales. Okay, so we are going to cover what suspensive sales really are. Then what will be examined on suspensive sale will be the higher purchase relief, or the suspensive sale relief, higher purchase relief, and the suspensives, or the suspensive relief. And also, the examiners will normally examine on how you would calculate, or you would account for repossessions. Okay, so these are the two items that are normally examined when a question involve a note on suspensive sales. Okay, so these are the two things that we are going to cover today. But as an introduction, what is a suspensive sale? Okay, so suspensive sale, we are saying in its basic form, a seller would have sold his goods or his specified asset on installment agreement. That means the buyer is not going to pay the whole amount instantly, or the whole amount when the seller and the buyer make the agreement, but rather the buyer can pay a deposit, then he can pay the remaining in maybe 5 equal installments in the next 5 years. Okay, so that is a suspensive sale. Okay, so we are saying in its basic form, taxpayers will sell their goods on higher purchase, that is movable goods, e.g. household furniture, or through suspensive sales, that is immovable property, e.g. land and buildings. I charge tax at 24.72%. This treatment is done where such a taxpayer is in the business of dealing in those items and ownership is only transferred upon full payment. The payment price is received in installments, e.g. 24 monthly installments. And according to the accruals or matching concept in accounting, we know that the income is declared in the year of sale in full. Therefore, this means that the installments being paid by the buyer cannot be income after the year the agreement was concluded. I think that one is quite clear. Then, according to Section 17 of the Income Tax Act, a higher purchase or suspensive sale allowance has to be granted to the seller as a deduction in the income statement. Okay. Then, this is calculated as D multiplied by GP divided by SP. That means D will be the amount outstanding at the end of year, then GP will be the gross profit, and then SP will be the sales proceeds. But today I'm going to concentrate on I purchase relief when a specified asset is sold and the terms of the agreement involve payments of installments. Okay, and also I'm going to cover the repossessions. Okay, so we have this question. We are told that HYT bought a factory building on 1 December 2015 for 200 for 400,000 and had been using it in its business since that date. On 2 March 2018, the company found a buyer willing to purchase the building for 750. This was the best bargain after several unsuccessful attempts by HYT Private Limited to sell the property. Selling expenses are 10% of the gross proceeds. The terms of the agreement were as follows. 1A, the buyer to pay 50% of the sale price in the year of the agreement, and then the balance over 2 years equal installments commencing 2019. Then ownership to pass through immediately upon payment of the first installment. Then there was also a disclosure that in the event that the buyer fails to pay an installment, the property will be repossessed. So the question is, show capital gains tax of HYT Private Limited for the periods 2018, 2019, and 2020. Okay, so let me just do a simple calculation here. The proceeds or the, let me just call it the proceeds. We are told that there were 400,000. Okay, so deposit we are told that is 50%. So if we say 400,000 multiplied by 50%, okay, that is the deposit. Let me just multiply it by minus one. Okay, that is 2018, the deposit payable in 2018. What about 2019, the first installment? Okay, that is the first installment. It's going to be payable in 2019. So how are we going to, what is the amount for the first installment? The amount will be equal to the proceeds less the deposit, then divided by 2. Okay, it's just a correction. The proceeds here is 750,000. Okay. The 400,000 was the initial cost of the building. Okay, so that will be 2019. Then 2020, that will be the second installment. That will be again equal to this one, because it was payable in two equal installments. Okay, that those are the relevant calculations. Now let's just quickly do the CGT tax procedure. That is gross capital amount is going to be the 750,000. Then we would normally say less exemptions, but let's just keep that one, less deductions. Okay, so the deductions will be the cost of the asset, which in this case is 400,000. Yes, then you will say less. Okay, we have inflation allowance will be equal to the cost of the asset multiplied by 2.5%, multiplied by, the asset was bought in 2015, so 2015, and it was sold in 2018, so 2015, 2016, 2017, 2018, that's 4 years. Okay, so we say multiply by 4. That will be the inflation allowance. Then in this case, we're just forgetting about the recoupment, because the effect of recoupment is zero. So then we have the selling price. Okay, so the selling price, we are told that is 10% of the gross capital amount. So we are going to say multiply by 10%. That means we are peaceful. Do we have any other deduction applicable? No. So we calculate the total deductions here. Okay, so we are summing all the deductions. Okay, so they're adding up this one. Then we say the gross capital amount less the sum of the deduction. That means it's 235. This is the, let me just call it the potential capital gain. We said we are going to grant this person a relief. And for CGT purposes, the relief is calculated as A multiplied by B, or then we divide everything by C, where A is the amount outstanding at year end, or the debtors, then that's A. Then A is the debtors. Then B is the potential capital gain. Then C is the gross capital amount. Okay. So let's come here and then we say hire purchase, let me say suspensive sales allowance. Okay, so we are going to say we have calculated our A here. By the end of 2019, by end of 2020, how much would be outstanding? It will be 750. Deduct the deposit, so it will be 735 outstanding. So that's our A. So we say A. We say our A. Then we multiply our A by the potential recoupment, which is this one, our capital gain, then divide by 750. So this would be our. Let me multiply it by minus one so that I show it. It is reducing the potential capital gain. So the capital gain now is equal to potential capital gain minus the relief. Okay. So that will be, ladies and gentlemen, that will be our capital gain for 2019. Okay. Then come 2020, this is 2018, okay. Come 2019, what are we going to do? So this capital gain, this suspensive sale allowance that is allowed in 2018 becomes gross capital amount in 2019. So we now have a gross capital amount of this one. Okay. The suspensive sale allowance in the previous year is gross capital amount in the current year. So currently we are in 2019. So let's deductions. Then we're going to again allow a higher purchase agreement. As long as we have a data outstanding at year end, we are always going to calculate a higher purchase allowance. So we are going to say the amount outstanding at end of 2019, it will be this one minus 2019 installment. So it will be 187,500. So the allowance will still be A, the amount outstanding, multiplied by B. B is the potential capital gain, in this case, this one, then divided by, this will not change the gross capital amount, okay. So that will be the capital, the higher purchase allowance in 2019. Okay, so capital gain in 2019 will be equal to the gross capital amount, then minus the relief. Okay. So come 2018 or in 2020, so this is 2019, then come 2020, the year of our final installment. So we're going to say gross capital amount. We said it will be the high purchase allowance that was allowed in the previous year. That will be this one, then multiply by minus one. Then this will be our gross capital amount in 2020. Then we say less deductions. Okay, so how are we going to calculate the deductions? We are going to calculate them. We are going to allow a higher purchase allowance. Okay, so if we can go back to the top, in 2020, if we make this final installment, it will be this one minus this one. So that means the data will be zero. So that means effectively, if we are going to say zero, which is our A, multiplied by the potential capital gain divided by 750, the gross capital amount, the allowance will be zero. So that means the whole is this one minus this one will be the capital gain in 20, capital gain in 20, in 2020. Okay, that is how you account for a suspensive sale, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, that was our requirement. So capital gains tax of HYT, private limited, for the period 2018, 2019, 2020. That is how you would do it. But I just want to touch a little bit on repossession, ladies and gentlemen. So let's say, our term, on the terms of the agreement on that quiz, you see number C is saying in the event that the buyer fails to pay in an installment, the property will be repossessed. So let's assume that in 2020, the buyer failed to pay that last installment. How are you going to account for CGT? Okay, so you follow these steps. In the year the agreement is cancelled, now we are saying it's 2020, the following steps should be followed. Number one, add all the payments made by the buyer to the seller since the agreement started. So all the payments, let me just go remove this one. Okay. Let's say all payments will be equal to the deposit that was paid, then we add what? We add the 2019 installment. So that means the buyer would have paid this total amount. Then what is the next step? The next step is to add all the capital gains on that asset. Okay, so we're now going to add all capital gains on that asset. Okay, so our capital gains will be we have for 2018 and also for 2019. Not 2020 because the agreement was cancelled in 2020. Okay, so the capital gains for 2019, we calculated it to be this one. Then the capital gain in 2020, we calculated it to be which one? To be this one. Okay, then for 2020, because the agreement is cancelled here, there are no capital gains. Okay. Then what we would do is this third step is saying subtract the capital gains from the total payments. So we are going to say is equal to, let us sum up the capital gains, is this one. Okay. Then we are going to say this one, the total of all payments minus the capital gain, which is this one. Okay, so this one will be the capital gain This will be the 2020 capital gain. Okay, so the note 3 is saying subtract the capital gains from total expenses made by the buyer to find the capital gains for the year in which the sale is cancelled. So we said that we assume that the sale was cancelled 2020. So that means this will be your capital gain. That means you are going to charge 20% year capital gains tax at 20%. For 2020, it will be this one, multiplied by 20%. Okay, so your capital gains tax will be 71,375. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that is how you account for capital gains. That is how you would account for capital gains for suspensive sale on a capital gains tax. There is also a way you calculate the higher purchase allowance and the suspensive sale implications when you sell like your goods in the normal course of a business. When you are trading, it's different from how you do it here, but the concept is just the same. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that was it. I just hope it was helpful. If you found this tutorial very helpful, you see this whole list of videos. Nitt-Gritt was conducting sessions, and you see, if you look closely on this, the first one, we have sent 3 views, then the third one, 14, 5, 1, 2, and 0, 0, 0. These with the zeros, I have just uploaded them today, and it was today's session on capital gains. We're touching on topics like schemes of reconstruction, bonus issue, rights issue, share reductions, disposal of PPR, substitution of business property, and everything. We digged deep into the nitty-gritties of every complicated aspect of capital gains tax. And these videos are for sale. So if you just want as you can see, they are almost an hour long because the application will only allow me to record up to an hour. So a 1 hour long video is just going for 200 baht. And if you want 2 videos, you're just going to pay 400 baht. And for CGT, the whole CGT course, we have, as you can see, we have 4 videos. So you should be prepared to pay for all these 4 videos. But let me assure you, ladies and gentlemen, those who are attending the sessions, they are always saying your sessions are insightful. So you should try Nitt-Gritt. With Nitt-Gritt, you can never go wrong. Okay, so we have the recordings. As you can see, and the recordings will be I'll be demonstrating everything. Like, let me just show you here. Okay, so as you see, gentlemen, I will be visualizing everything, and as I said earlier, those who are attending the sessions, if you can conduct them, they will tell you, they will obviously recommend you Nitt-Gritt. With Nitt-Gritt, I repeat again, you can never go wrong. So we do taxation, we do financial reporting, and on this coming Sunday, we are going to hold a free tutorial or free session on the conceptual framework for financial reporting. Be sure to tune in on how you can join the session. You can inbox myself on my WhatsApp platform, or you can ask the question on our Twitter account page. You can just search for Nitt-Gritt Private College, and then type your question there. We will respond to you and we will give you the link. Otherwise, have a good day, ladies and gentlemen.